Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. Today I'm going to talk about stereotypes. Now I want to do a video. Someone left in the comments that I should do a video about SJW stereotypes because SJWs come up with their own stereotypes and they're really wonky, and it's good to actually kind of look at these things, and it sounds like a fun thing to do, and I want to do that in some video in the future. But first of all, I want to go over stereotypes in general and just how they benefit writing and why SJWs can't write a good story because they don't use stereotypes, because they think anybody who uses a stereotype is obviously a racist and a bigot or anything else that they can call them in a negative light. Which brings me to my first point, which is the fact that if you look today for the definition of stereotype in most dictionaries, and you look online, and certainly if you talk to anybody who's any kind of SJW or leaning in that direction, they're going to put a negative connotation on stereotypes. They're going to call it something negative. It's going to have sort of a negative moral attachment to it. Now, just a little background about me. I collect books. It's not really collect. Books just seem to gravitate towards me. And they're not the normal kind of books that normal people would actually pick out. You know, I just come home with boxes of books at times. But they're not novels. I rarely ever buy a novel. They're things like, you know, ancient history or philosophy or How to Fix Things, or encyclopedias or dictionaries, other languages, stuff like that. So the thing is that I have a lot of dictionaries, a lot of different kinds of dictionaries, different language, different dictionaries, all these kinds of things. And these are some of my books. And I just for fun, I went looking through them because I do this every once in a while because I'm always talking about logic. Logic is based on simple apprehension, which simple apprehension is basically sort of understanding the definition of a thing. So you try to understand where it comes from. So I look through definitions. And so I'm going through definitions of stereotype. And I know this, but I wanted to make sure. But going through older dictionaries, if you look at any dictionary prior to, say, about 2005, maybe a little later, stereotype as a definition has no negative attachment at all. There's no negative connotation to the word at all. It's a noun. It's just a thing. It's just a thing. Okay, it doesn't have any moral standard attached to it of good or bad. It doesn't have any of these SJW things, because the SJWs are pushing this idea, and they've been pushing it for the last 10 or 15 years now, and they've really got it going well, that any stereotype is a negative bad thing. They want you to believe that. But you know what? Where the word actually comes from and where and how it's been used for almost all of history up until the last about 10 or 12 years. No, it was just a noun. It was just a thing. It had no negativity attached to it at all. It comes from two ancient Greek words, stainos, which is strong, and typos, which is type, you know, and it originally meant an actual typeset piece, you know, like you would have in your old typewriters, where it would have at the end of your little bar that went up, there was a typeset, right? That would be your stereotype. And so it got transferred, the word in its use got transferred over to types of people and how to use them, and especially in literature. But stereotypes are just a way to describe something. It's just a way for human beings to work. And actually, stereotyping is something that is implanted in human nature. Okay, it's part of your primitive human brain. There's no way to get rid of it. And here's another thing. Again, I'm always saying that SJWs, they're your useful idiots of your socialists and your communists, of course. And the socialists and your communists always say that no man has no human nature at all, because then there would have to be a higher thing in order, a higher standard than them themselves to make up rules. But they don't want any higher standard. So they say, no, there's no human nature. They would say everything is just nurture. Everything is nurture. But that's ridiculous, of course. There is a human nature. We all know that there's a human nature just by being human. And one of the things of human nature is stereotyping. It comes from the fact that we were hunter-gatherers for so long. It comes from pre-civilization, where you're hunting with your tribe, you know, and it comes partly from fight or flight instincts, you know, so it's part of instinct. Because in your old state, you know, you're walking through the jungle, you got to take in as many things as possible to see how many of them are threats to you, because you got to keep yourself alive. So it's going to trigger your fight or flight. And the way that your brain does that, because your conscious brain, the brain that's thinking about every little thing, it can't think about every single last little thing you're seeing while you're walking through a jungle or while you're walking through a crowd of people. So what it does, it puts things into categories. It stereotypes them, and it puts them into categories of dangerous, non-dangerous. And so that instinctual part of your brain puts things into these two categories. And so this is the origin of where stereotyping comes from. And so it puts them into these two categories. And if it's non-threatening, it ignores them. If it's threatening, then they give it some attention and get ready for it to trigger fight or flight. Okay, so that's what happens. So this is where stereotypes come from. So it also leads into, we still use it, right? It leads into the idea of good first impressions. Good first impressions is that exact thing working in your brain. When you meet someone for the first time, your primitive part of your brain is thinking, is this person a threat or not? And if it deems that they are a threat, you're not going to like them. If it deems that they're not a threat, you're going to say, oh, that's a first good impression. It might not be the best first impression, but it's a good first impression. And so the primitive part of your brain still works like that. It's part of your human nature. You stereotype things in order, it's a mechanism to stay alive. It's just part of your human nature. And so this gets translated into literature in a very interesting way. I find this very interesting anyways. And it's almost a tightrope walking kind of way for literature that you bring this out. Because I would say that you cannot write, especially a good story or any kind of a novel or story, even a comic book, if you don't use stereotypes. If you don't use stereotypes, you're not going to have anything that is of any value at all. You have to use stereotypes, because this is the way that it works in literature. In literature, you always use stereotypes. You don't have to in every instance, but you got to use them at some point. And I would say, of course, that part of this is because, as I've been saying in a lot of my videos, that your literature, your entertainment is escapism. Escapism is supposed to be leisure, and leisure is non-work. So if your brain gets dragged into the category of this is work, then it's no longer leisure, it's no longer entertainment, it's no longer escapism. You don't want it as a customer, as someone who's reading, right? So if you're always using something new, then your brain of your reader is going to be dragged into this is work, and therefore it's going to be thrown in the corner and it's not going to actually be read. So you have to use stereotypes. And the writer's rule basically is that if you take your stereotype and you keep it, let's just talk about characters. We'll not talk about stereotypes in tropes or, you know, your settings or anything like that. Let's just talk about characters itself. If you have a character and he's a stereotypical something, stereotypical X, and then you keep him in that stereotype, he becomes part of the background. And if you take that character and you put him in a stereotype and then you tweak it, then you actually make him part of the foreground and make him interesting. And I would say tweak it. Some people say break it, but I don't want to say break it, because SJWs are always talking about breaking stereotypes. But when they talk about breaking stereotypes, they're talking about getting rid of it and obliterating it completely. And so that no one ever says it again, no one ever mentions it again, no one ever thinks of it again, and all mentions of it in history are completely erased. That's how they break stereotypes. That's their idea of breaking a stereotype. But in your normal literary way of breaking a stereotype, they mean something completely different. They mean that you take your stereotype and you just tweak it a little bit. You tweak it in a different way a lot of the time, but that's how you do it. You change something in it. And again, this is part of your instinct, your instinctual mind just working, because have your character who is already part of a stereotype and doesn't change, he becomes part of the background. So your background of your mind recognizes that your character is something that is of no consequence. It's not going to trigger fight or flight. It's not going to trigger interest, and therefore it just fades into the background. But if you have a character that is a stereotypical character, and then something draws your interest, you tweak the stereotype just a little bit, then it's going to draw the reader's interest. And again, this is where it has to walk a tightrope, literature has to, because it can't can't take the stereotype and tweak it so much so that it triggers your fight or flight. Now, again, there are some genres where you want to do that, like horror or thrillers, I suppose, things like that, where you really want to ramp up the adrenaline in your reader, and you can do that. But for the most part, you don't do that. Because again, when you do that, if you trigger that fight or flight within the person, within the reader, they're going to start thinking of it as work most of the time. And when they start thinking of it as work, it's not entertainment, yada, yada, same as I said before. So what you do is you tweak it, because think about it in terms of, you know, as your ancestors, you're walking through the forest with your tribe at your back, right? And you hear some trees rustling and you know it's not you. Well, what does everybody do? They stop dead in their tracks. They stop dead in their tracks to see if it's something that's going to kill them, right? So you stop, it grabs your interest, you stop. You make sure it's not something that's going to kill you. So obviously it's not something that's going to kill you, but you know that it is something, it's something that you don't know. So you think to yourself, maybe it's something I can kill in order to eat or some other reason. And therefore you start to have interest in it. You're not going to just walk away. You're going to actually have some interest in that rustling leaves, because first of all, you know, it's not going to kill you. So, you know, you got your tribe at your back and you're good. And so you're safe enough to go and investigate it. And this is what literature is actually supposed to do. It is a mock fight or flight situation. And it's one that is run through your brain over and over again, right? It brings you into that mock situation, and it's supposed to trigger it just enough so that you are interested. And you're always hooking your audience. You always have to hook your audience. You have to do it in many different times and many different ways. I mean, you have to write a good blurb just for the back of your book. Because most people will pick up the book, you know, say they're at an airport, they pick up the book, they read the back of the book, they think, okay, that interests me, because I'm hooked with that. And then they flip to the first page and the second page, and they read the first two pages, and then you got to hook them again there. And once they read those first two pages, they think, okay, I'll buy it. And so they buy the book. And so they take it home and they start reading it. And they read the first chapter and then the second chapter, and they think, you got to hook them again, because then they think, oh, well, I'm really enjoying this. And then as you go through the book, you got to hook them again and again and again to make sure that they keep reading and get to the end of the book and they think it's a good book. That's what you got to do. So you got to take your stereotype and you got to tweak it, and you got to make sure that you already first just draw the interest of the reader so that you trigger something in them so that they know it's a stereotype. So they know it's not work. So you already recognize a stereotype, and then it gets tweaked, and therefore it makes them interested just enough to keep on going and keep on going. And you do it in many different ways. You can do it with one person, or you can do it with a crowd. You can do it in internal thoughts. You can do it in external conversation. You can do it with comedy. You can do it with drama. And so you try to mix all these things up so that you never do it twice in the same way in the same book. But you always got to hook them, hook your audience over and over again. What you do is you take a stereotype, so you get them interested, and then you tweak it so that, you know, so they're interested enough using the stereotype so that they're familiar with it, and then you tweak it so that it hooks them. And that's the way that good writing actually works. And by the way, as I was saying in my last Golden Age video, that's the way if you want your book actually to do good, not just in your own region, not just in your own section of the world, say your own country or your own hemisphere, you got to use stereotypes. You got to use them more and more, and you got to use them in very good ways. As I was saying in that video, you know, if you want to make a movie that the Chinese will actually buy and watch, because they like actual American movies, they really do, but they got to be stereotypical American movies. You got to have Johnny John Cowboy Man as your main character so they can recognize him and they can jump right aboard and say, yeah, I recognize this. This is American. I know what's going to come next. And then you got to hook him again and again. So these things have to be used. Stereotypes have to be used in order to draw in your audience, in order to make a good book. And this is why SJWs cannot write a good story. It is one of the major reasons why they cannot write a good story, because they will not use stereotypes. They will think that they can make their own stereotypes, but of course, since they're making their own stereotypes, they're making up something. And again, your brain's going to think, okay, this is work. I don't recognize the stereotype, therefore this is not escapism, this is not entertainment, this is not something I want to read. Throw it in the corner. Or they're trying to build up their character by simply, you know, making one thing after another, after another, after another. And again, it's not an easy stereotype to build upon. Again, it's work. You don't want to actually have to go through that process when you're talking about entertainment, when you're talking about escapism. Or they make a bad first impression, because again, first impressions are really good and are really useful and needed in a book. Your character's got to make a good first impression. Again, you got to have the same thing with the first impression that I'm talking about at the first of the video. You know, your character's got to make a good first impression. It is extremely hard to break a bad first impression, even in normal everyday life, but the same thing transfers over to literature. If you're introducing your character and they make a bad first impression, people are not going to want to read this book, especially if that's the main character. They're going to say, why am I reading this? I don't like the main character. And they're going to throw it away. And SJWs always do this. They make a bad first impression with their characters because, well, most of the time their characters are idiots or just people who are bad people. And so you're saying to yourself, yeah, this is horrible. I don't want to read this. And this, again, because they won't use actual stereotypes, because they think that everybody who uses stereotypes is a racist or bigot or something else like this, and so they can't use any kind of stereotypes, then they can't actually write a story that's going to appeal to anybody, nor is it going to hook you. And it's just going to be boring. So the only SJW stereotype that I'll go over here is the non-offensive. Okay, they're just going to write characters that are non-offensive. You know, there's other ones like the LOL so random or the non-offensive humor, but you know, that's all that they can use. And since those things are boring, again, and they can only use the same one over and over and over again, then that's boring. Even if you do get hooked at the first, it just becomes dry as burnt toast. You know, it's nothing that you want. It's not a good story. And they SJWs can't write good stories because of this. They really, really can't. This is one of the major reasons. If you want to be a good writer, you actually have to use stereotypes. You actually have to use them in ways that are interesting. You have to use them in ways that draw in a reader. And that's something that SJWs just can't do. All right, so I'm going a little bit over on my time here again. If I gave you anything new to think about, hit like, hit subscribe, and leave me a comment. Give me something new to think about. I love all the comments that I get. I thank everybody for leaving comments. I thank everybody for hitting like and subscribe as well. I want to thank all of the people who subscribed to me, and especially you people who hit like. That's really, I love to see those likes on these videos. It very much tells me that my videos are appreciated. Thank you very much. All right. I'll see you later. Bye.